Major funding for Charlie Rose is provided by the people at DuPont, originators of products and ideas that make a difference in everyday life. DuPont, better things for better living. And by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and the annual financial support of viewers like you. Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
Welcome to our broadcast. Tonight, a look at Boris Yeltsin's political future with Professor Stephen Cohen and his appraisal of the Clinton administration. Also, an update on the O.J. Simpson trial with trial lawyer Gerald Lefcourt. The first prosecution witness testified earlier today. And later in our broadcast, a conversation with cellist Yo-Yo Ma. We begin with Russia. Joining me now, Stephen Cohen. He is a professor of Russian studies at Princeton University. He has just returned from Russia, where he had a chance to firsthand talk to some of the people there that are making some of the decisions and to come back and give us a firsthand report. I refer before this to this week's edition of Newsweek magazine, and it says, and it gives you some example, you know, of the horror that is taking place there. Russia's TV war will news coverage turn a remote campaign into Yeltsin's Vietnam. Chechnya marks a turning point nonetheless. It is Russia's first television war. I am pleased to have back at this table, Stephen Cohen. Welcome.
Thank you. Tell me about how bad it is and how dire it is there and what's happening in that country because of Chechnya.
I saw you on the show a couple weeks before I left in early December. I said the situation was bad there. It's worse than I thought. Every negative, anti-democratic, anti-reform factor has been accelerated and brought to the fore by this war. There's no going back. It's hard to imagine a good outcome. I was impressed also very much by the fact that this is Yeltsin's war, not Russia's war. That is to say, virtually the entire nation is in opposition
to
the war.
It's Yeltsin's war and not the army's war. It's not Gratchev's war.
It's Gratchev's war, but yeah. Gratchev isn't the army. But it's Yeltsin and
Gratchev
his
defense minister.
It's Yeltsin's entourage's war and the nation. 70-80% of the population, the mothers of Russia, the political class, insofar as we can tell, polls, is against.
What are the likely outcomes?
Nothing good. Yeltsin has no support. He now rules on the basis of the army and the police and the KGB. He can no longer lead reform. He can no longer lead democratically. Well, there is a conceivable way he could call elections, but no one believes that with 8% in the polls standing he has, he will do that.
So what's going to happen?
If his health holds up, he may be able to hold on because there's no other institution, no other force in Russian society capable of toppling him. But whether there will actually be any more elections in Russia is now a very big question mark. Talk of reform under Yeltsin is now nonsense. The Clinton administration's equation of Yeltsin with reform is regarded with enormous dark mockery in Russia.
I want to come to the Clinton administration in just a second, but stay with me in terms of the reform movement, which Yeltsin, when he took command of, in a sense, and has sort of seen it eradicated. Is it dead? Is it over? Has the West lost an opportunity to infuse support for that reform, for that democratic movement, to give it life?
Certainly those are the right questions, but they're separate questions. Democratization, the process of turning Russia, which never had any democracy, into a functionally democratic system, that has stopped. It has even gone back. Yeltsin rules by decree. The parliament has no power. No force in society, even though society is opposed, can stop this war. After all, as we talk today, in the sixth week of the war, the carnage goes on. I mean, imagine what's happening. What began as the Holocaust of a city, Grozny, the capital of Chechnya, is becoming the genocide of a people, the Chechens. It's an enormous crime, a war crime, and yet it goes on, even more intense today than it was 2 or 3 weeks ago. It cannot be stopped. There are no democratic institutions in Russia capable of stopping it, and those democratic institutions that exist are being undermined by this war.
Okay, you brought back this. This is a Russian calendar for 1995, I assume. Mm-hmm. And I think the significance here is this caricature of Yeltsin, yes?
Well, popular culture in any country expresses a certain opinion about how leaders are perceived, and that's what you see now. And
in the same way that late-night talk show comedians, what they say and the ridicule they visit on politicians is suggestive of something.
Exactly. And what you see is the portrait of a corrupt emperor, a kind
This is?
That's the Prime Minister Viktor Chernomyrdin, who has turned out to be Vice President Al Gore's best Russian friend, a kind of backup to the Clinton administration if Yeltsin falls.
All right. And this is?
This is unknown to America, but this is the Speaker of the Parliament, who in fact serves Yeltsin.
All right. This is?
This is Mr. Chubais, who has been in charge of the privatization that the United States is so proud of in Russia, but is a very suspicious figure in Russia and very unpopular.
This is
Mr. Kozarov, the foreign minister whom Secretary of State Christopher met with just recently.
Yeah. A good man? Or Yeltsin too?
I believe this is a man who began as a good man and was corrupted by power. He's now an apologist for a policy that is destructive of democracy in Russia.
And here is Mr.
Well, this appears to be the new Western hope. An economist, Grigory Yavlinsky, English-speaking, about 10% in the Russian polls, leader of a Russian parliament.
A reformist in the parliament?
A reformist, pro-democratic. I know him quite well. And William Sapphire of the New York Times has taken to writing about him regularly as an alternative to Yeltsin.
He wrote a piece, in fact, on January 30th called After Yeltsin, Who? In the most recent poll of Russian voters, Grigory Yavlinsky, his name means the man who appears, now draws more support for president than Boris Yeltsin.
Well, more support in the large cities. In the provinces, it's not the case.
All right, and here comes somebody we all know.
We all know, Mr. Zhirinovsky.
Yeah. And he is supporting Yeltsin with respect to Chechnya?
Yes, the leader of an ultra-nationalist party, even quasi-fascist in some regards, and the winner of the last elections, December 1993 parliamentary elections, now supports Mr. Yeltsin.
All right.
Mr. Yeltsin's war, I should say.
Well, that's it right there. Here we go.
This may need to be censored. This is the leader of the Communist Party with a good deal of exposure below the waist going on there.
You talked to a lot of communists when you were over there?
Talk to him.
Yeah.
Spent 2 hours with him.
Yeah. You see Gorbachev this time?
I did,
Yeah, and what does he say?
He's utterly opposed to the war and sees the reforms that he thinks he began going down the drain in this war.
Does he see Russia going to civil war?
He worries about it. He thinks early elections could save the country.
All right. What do you think of the way the Clinton administration has handled this, and what opportunities have they missed?
I voted for Clinton with great hope. I think the war in Chechnya is a criminal war, and we are accomplices in a criminal war. And the Russian liberal press that we've always admired, I was just reading as I came up here today, says exactly the same thing. We have become accomplices in a criminal war. We have insisted on claiming the Yeltsin on two grounds, that he embodies reform in Russia and there is no alternative to Yeltsin in Russia. These are both false. And as Zbigniew Brzezinski, I haven't agreed with Zbig in 30 years until recently, but he wrote, in all honor to him, recently in the Washington Post, Chechnya has become the cemetery of America's moral reputation. It's a very serious thing.
Because we did not do what?
Because
the rally cry in Washington was, you know, it's their problem and they should take care of it on their own. It's a domestic problem for Russia.
That's right. What we really said was something even more monstrous in a way. We said, do it quickly, do it more efficiently, get it over with. In other words, kill more efficiently. Don't be such military bunglers. It's a terrible thing to have said. And we've been shamed in Russia. I personally believe, let me say one thing, in Russia some people believe that Yeltsin should resign. Many people think he should. That a coalition government should be formed and then new elections and a new constitution carried out. This won't happen in Russia because there's no principle of honorable democratic resignation in the face of policy debacle. I personally believe that the architects of the American policy in Russia, the main architects, should resign.
I assume that's Strobe Talbot?
It would be Secretary of State Christopher, the second man in the State Department, Strobe Talbot, perhaps the American ambassador in Russia, Mr. Pickering. The men who had...
Because they misread what?
They didn't misread. They supported Yeltsin in everything he did, not just Chechnya, but the attack. We spoke here 15, 16 months ago when Yeltsin sent the tanks against the parliament, right. And it gives me no satisfaction to say that I was right in arguing
that he was not a Democrat, and this was such an anti-democratic act.
And that a man capable of attacking a parliament with tanks was capable of anything. And now we see it. The administration was warned, and it went along for whatever reason.
Now, what was their alternative?
Their alternative was to do what we do with other countries, deal with Yeltsin as the elected president, but not become his cheerleader. We became his cheerleader, his accomplice, his partner.
But what would we have done? Would we have stepped in and said to Yeltsin, we terribly oppose the way you are running your government and decisions that you are making, and so therefore we're going to withhold aid or not support appropriation of aid for your administration, even though, you know, they desperately needed that aid to try to get the economy underway? And
we could give aid without endorsing and cheerleading Yeltsin. After all, let me give you the contrast. We don't tell John Major what to do in his domestic politics and then applaud when he does things. We don't tell Mitterrand what to do in France. We don't tell Kohl what to do in Germany.
But what was the applause?
The applause was, is that, for example, when Yeltsin attacked the parliament and shut it down with tanks, we publicly, our government, said this is a good thing to do, he did the right thing, and we took over his own polemics against his own enemies.
Because we thought he was the best hope for reform in Russia at the time, and that was seemed to be, at the time, a consensus.
A consensus in this country?
Yes.
No, there were four of us in this country who in the press said it was an unwise act. It wasn't a complete consensus.
Okay.
Some people here warned against it and said, don't do it.
Yeah, don't do it.
Don't do this. Don't get involved in this cauldron of Russian politics, which you, the Clinton administration, do not understand. And it is not our right, and we don't have the power to be so deeply involved in internal Russian affairs. And the result of that is, with our backing, Yeltsin has felt that he had a free hand, while still getting our aid, to wage this war. The question now becomes, do we give this aid he wants from the International Monetary Fund, and we are a sponsor of that fund, therefore we have a vote, do we give these billions of dollars he now wants, which in effect will pay for this war, which in fact goes on today as we talk?
Yeah.
Do you want to pay for the war against Chechnya?
No.
No, neither do I. And yet I've been an advocate
of aid to Russia. But do I desperately believe that it is in our national interest for, this is easy to say, and we had a window of opportunity for reform to succeed in Russia, and that the stakes of it succeeding were huge. They were huge in the same way that the stabilization of the peso in Mexico, the stakes of that are huge, because if we can somehow see reform flourish in Russia, and not a resumption of the kind of Cold War animosity, it's certainly in our best interest, you know. And if we lose that momentum, if we lose that opportunity, we set our own foreign policy back. Am I wrong about that?
Let me be the
right,
host.
Sure.
But Mr. Rose, what you're saying is that we Americans have the right and the power to shape the Russian future. Is that what you want to tell me?
No, I don't think we have a power to shape it, but I think that in a sense that there is, I don't think we have a power to shape, but I do think that there was at least an opportunity with Gorbachev and what followed. We don't know what Gorbachev would have done if he had been in the same position,
right,
and what mistakes he made. He clearly made mistakes,
right,
and you clearly think he was a better leader than Yeltsin, correct?
Yeah, yes, for Russia.
And more of
for
a Democrat,
Russia.
For Russia.
For Russia,
than,
yeah.
In this case. But I just think, I mean, what concerns me, and Senator Nunn made this point over the weekend, is that a resumption, you know, of hostility with the Soviet Union, if they now become, Russia becomes captive of anti-American forces.
Today.
You know, and the demise of the reform democratic movement over there,
yeah,
is clearly not in our national interest and could be costly to our treasury.
We cannot buy,
right,
save, or finance, or sell to the Russian people a democratic movement. Russian Democrats must behave in Russia in a way that win them followers in Russia, and under Yeltsin they have not. They have taken...
Is it all Yeltsin's fault?
I believe that historians will write in 10, 15, 20, or 50 years that Yeltsin's leadership was a catastrophe for post-communist Russia, and all the great opportunities,
yeah,
for Russia to evolve in a direction of democracy and economic markets, this window you're talking about, were wasted by Yeltsin's leadership. And that is a serious, very serious thing to say, but more serious, because we are Americans, not Russian, and we have our obligations, is our persistent support for this leadership, which has led us to this, as Brzezinski said, graveyard of our moral reputation in Chechnya.
Thank you for coming.
It's bad news. I'm sorry.
I know it is. It is bad news, and not only for the Russian people and the Chechen people, but also in terms of some sense of...
But Russia is a country with remarkable capabilities, and there will be good news one day.
Thank you, Steve. Stephen Cohen here. Coming up, we will look at an important day in the trial of O.J. Simpson. Gerald Lefcourt has been watching that and commenting on it for CBS News, and he'll be here for a quick update and debriefing on what happened today. Back in a moment. Gerald Lefcourt is here. He is a well-known and highly regarded New York criminal lawyer. He has been consulting with CBS News as that network news department has covered the O.J. Simpson trial. He's here to give us an update on an important day in a very small amount of time. Thank you for coming. Tell me what's the significance. First of all, what did you think of Cochran's opening statement?
He started out like a storm. His first day was just dynamite. He took each piece of the prosecution case and ripped it apart.
But did he rip it apart by using witnesses that are really not, that could have been demolished later?
Well, that remains to be seen. The point is he was animated. I mean, social scientists tell us that jurors start leaning right from the jump, right from the opening statement.
Like lean in as if they're interested in listening?
No, leaning to one side.
So
the goal is to make sure that the jurors are not leaning towards the other side, because that will inform everything that they hear. So what he did was balance the playing field and level it by being very animated and very effective.
Was it misconduct?
No, there's no question under California law this is misconduct. You must disclose the names of your witness and give witness statements. That's
then
not true.
Was it a mistake?
Probably not. The judge found that it was intentional and told the jury that it was intentional. And when the judge admonished the jury and told the jury that this fellow committed a violation of law, he sort of was wounded, and he got back up to try to finish his opening, and the pizzazz was gone, the animation was gone, and I think a lot of the effectiveness was gone, certainly for a while, until he had a break, and then he came back a little stronger. And sort of dealt with a lot of the prosecution evidence, talked about a sock timeline, how many people had looked at that sock, prosecution experts, defense experts, and there was no blood on it for 6 weeks, and all of a sudden, August 4th, 6 weeks later, they find blood, and it turns out to be Nicole Simpson's blood, and the clearest blood sample in the whole case. So they're claiming that it was put there. And they did a timeline on the time of the murder.
Yeah. Is it reversible error, the decision the judge made to give the prosecution an opportunity to come back another 10 minutes of
probably not. But even though it is totally unique and probably no criminal trial that anybody has ever heard of was this permitted. But under the circumstances, making a finding that it was an intentional tactical advantage that the defense tried to, sandbag the prosecution, the judge undoubtedly, I think, is going to get away with it. In a long trial, 5 or 6 month trial, it's not as important as it would be in a 2 day trial.
Did it shift the momentum?
There's no question that Johnny Cochran was wounded when the judge admonished the jury, and Marsha Clark had an opportunity today with her opening statement to do real damage. Amazingly, she didn't do as much damage as she could, because the defense opening was all about what the prosecution didn't tell you. And she had an opportunity to say, the reason why we didn't tell you is twofold. One is we dismissed these nuts or these liars.
But she did say that in terms of the limits allowed her by the judge, didn't she?
Well, the judge limited
her. With her. He told her she could go.
That's true. She dealt with the issues that she was told she can go into, but she didn't do it in the way she could have to really hurt the defense. I mean, it was effective, to be sure. But I don't know where the jury is at. They must be saying to themselves, what is this guy doing that has permitted this unusual thing, and the judge telling us to essentially disregard lots of things that he said?
Would the prosecution have been better off, in your judgment, we don't know, to have allowed those witnesses, who clearly are challengeable, to get on the stand and then demolished them and may sent the defense crumbling?
Well, they're going to do that, too. I mean, they're going to have it both ways, because the defense promised the jury that they would hear these witnesses. And undoubtedly, the defense intends on calling them. I don't think that they would have gotten up and said to the jurors, you're going to hear, Marianne Gerchus and others, unless they intend to put them on, and the prosecution is going to be ready for bear.
Three of your colleagues were here the other night, who you know well, and two of them thought it would, this case will result in a conviction, and the third said mistrial. And when you look at it now, where do you think it's going?
Well, I tend to think that Cochran promised a little too much, he sort of bit off more than he had to. This whole business about the physical problems, I mean, you look at O.J. Simpson's body as displayed by the defense, to then argue that he was incapable of doing these things, but he could play golf and he could make, a exercise video. I think that they probably went a little too far, and unless they deliver, I see them in trouble.
Yeah. So what you're saying is not just the defendant's credibility, it's also the defendant's attorney's credibility.
Absolutely. Jurors want to be able to believe the lawyer that they're following, and it's difficult to follow a lawyer. If the judge tells you that the lawyer can't be trusted and violates the law, and that you yourself have doubts about that person's credibility.
Is it possible, does Simpson now have to take the stand?
You know, it's hard for me to imagine that he will take the stand matter what. No, I don't think he will. I cannot imagine him on that stand because there's just so much to answer for. There's so much, the whole relationship with Nicole, every argument they ever had suddenly is open to scrutiny. And it's very, very difficult for him to hold all that together. So my sense is that that is a last resort. And of course, you never know. I mean, if the case is going down the drain, they just may put him on.
Here is what was interesting to me. I mean, I thought that Cochran got so much praise at the beginning. What was interesting to me, it looked like an opening statement of desperation in terms of which they reach for. And you're saying if they reach too far, they'll have the chair knocked out from under you and you can hang yourself.
The prosecutor's going to say, he promised. Yeah. He promised he would prove A, B, and C. And now we're here at closing statement. Did he prove that? Yeah. And this is the problem with trying to do too much in an opening.
How much dissension is there within that defense team that we hear about?
Obviously, you're dealing with large egos and a national media looking at them all, and they all want, of course, appear to be good. I think that there's too much there. There's too much at the table. A lot of it is unnecessary. They have some absolutely very fine people there, and any two of them could have done it. And I think the problem is, there's too many chefs here.
Yeah, and they'll clearly try to make the LAPD be the victim.
Well,
Cochran, put on trial.
Cochran has got to take the lead there. This is really coming down to a race case. That's why Christopher Darden stood up on the, open for the prosecution. I don't think he would have been in the case, but for the fact that they have eight black jurors and a defense attorney who's a well-known and fabulous black trial lawyer. So I think that race is a major issue here. And it's so major, you could think about it, what would happen if one of those detectives who the defense is going to attack as racist and planting evidence was a black man? LAPD is still suffering from the composition of the force.
And the chief of the LAPD is a black man, Willie Williams.
And it's just a shame he hasn't had time to make the changes I'm sure he wants to make. But I don't think you want four white detectives pretending to go from a crime scene to a defendant's
home. What's in the envelope?
Well, now I can tell you the truth.
Right.
It's really Shapiro's bill. Now, I think it's a knife.
Yeah. And is it a knife that Simpson owned?
There was testimony at the preliminary hearing that he bought a knife, and the defense obviously knew that it wasn't the murder weapon, and they went to a different judge, secretly, and got that judge to issue an order to seize it.
I close with this. We're out of time. It is the notion that the prosecution seems to be establishing motive first, with all the testimony about the 9/11 call and whatever relationship there was between Mr. Simpson and his wife, his late wife.
Sure, they're actually trying that assault back in 1989 first to show that he's a violent person who's capable of beating her. If he's capable of beating her, he's capable of killing her.
Gerald Lefcourt, thank you. My thanks to CBS News, where you were working with them in terms of their coverage. We'll be right back. The great Yo-Yo Ma.
Yo-Yo Ma is here. He is considered by many people to be the greatest instrument talent alive, the most popular classical instrumentalist alive, perhaps the most gifted cellist alive today. He is considered also to be a great guy, and I am pleased to have him on this broadcast for a conversation about music and about his life as he sees it at this time. It is a pleasure to have you here.
How do you know I'm alive?
Well, I've listened to your music, and I know you can play music.
Okay.
It's great to have you here, really.
It's wonderful.
It's been a while since I've been wanting to have you on this program for a long time, and I see you occasionally at Kennedy Center and places like that.
It's so great. It's great that you do these shows and you let people talk about whatever they want.
Let geniuses come and talk. I mean, when did you know that you had something special in terms of musicality? You had something that other people would call prodigy.
I still don't know. I'm not trying to skirt the issue.
Yeah, all right.
But
don't
I was
be
told
modest.
I had talent when I was a kid. I was probably 8, 9, you know. But basically, I played music at home and I liked it some of the time. I didn't like it some of the time. I liked practicing some of the time, but I didn't like practicing some of the time.
Home I think at first was Paris, or was it?
Yes, I was born in Paris.
Right.
We moved to the States when I was 7.
Yeah.
So I guess when I first went to music school, which is Juilliard pre-college, it's about 9 years old. I'd started studying with Leonard Rose, Chetty
right.
Robbins, and going to school, maybe playing in orchestra, playing chamber music with other people, that become a little more aware that you're okay. But no, I didn't think I was particularly special. Going to summer camp when I was 15, that was now kind of went a little wild.
Yeah. yes, I've heard you left the cello outside in the rain and stuff like that.
You know, you do want to give it a good wash
yeah,
once in a while.
Do, yes. Nothing more than a dirty cello.
Oh, no, we can't have that. So, but then I guess I realized I was, you know, yeah. did okay. But actually, it takes a long time to know what you can do and to know what is it that you hope to do. And it took many, many years to work it out. Does that sound odd to you?
It does, because I assume that it's all of a sudden at 4 you were playing Bach and somebody said, my God, we've got a genius here. You were doing that, weren't you?
Yeah, I don't like the word genius, though. I played my first concert when I was 5. I know I'd played for President Kennedy by the time I was 7.
Yeah.
Okay, but those things really don't mean much to a 7-year-old because you really don't understand what you're doing. And so I think... And one of the terms, you know, prodigy, genius, the difficult terms, because I don't like the word genius anyway, because I don't think that's well, facility, yes. Prodigy,
talent, skill.
Talent possibly, ease at you know, learning certain things. But kids learn like sponges. No, but everybody can learn a foreign language.
But are you smart at everything?
Fluently.
I mean, are you...
No.
Smart at math.
Talk
I mean,
to my children. They'll tell you I'm not smart at anything.
I mean, can you solve mathematical problems?
I was pretty good at math.
There's a correlation between math and music, don't they?
I was really good at math until I was in 4th grade.
But then it got the division, and you were out.
Oh, boy. And, but I still am interested in math, but I'm not, you know, I haven't followed it up, but potentially it would have been an interesting subject for me.
Why the cello?
It was the biggest instrument I could find and that I could play.
Mm.
And I wanted to play the double bass
because
that was truly the biggest instrument.
Yeah.
And since my sister played violin, I didn't want to touch that because I, you know, she was too good at it.
Yeah.
And so I wanted to.
And she was a gifted violinist.
She was very
she
gifted.
She may still be, although she's a physician now, is she not?
Right, that's right. You did your research.
Well, you hear about the famous Ma family.
Oh, I don't know. But she is a. In fact, a very good violinist, and she played a concert, in fact, 2 days ago, and apparently she was very happy to be playing.
Yeah, but was there some kind of male thing here in which they said, young Yo-Yo comes along, and your sister, even though a gifted violinist, you kind of left over her,
I think
and they
was
said
more
the family
extroverted.
Focus will be on the son and
there's
not
a
the
little
daughter.
Bit of that.
Yeah.
I think my parents probably thought that music was, it's a hard life, going out, touring, doing stuff like that. But I think also I was much more extroverted at a younger age than my sister. So, and that kind of extroversion helped me play. I was probably a better performer early on, and that doesn't mean, but I got a lot of musical taste, musical knowledge from my sister. She played piano, maybe we just played pieces together. So I have a deep respect for what she knows. I just happen to be able to do the extroverted part.
I want to talk about that later in terms of character and individuality and passion and how that fuels music and how that adds to, you know, the expression that you give music. But in terms of this instrument, do you feel a physical relationship to it?
Absolutely. The cello, the strings of the cello are your vocal cords, you know. Your right arm are your lungs, basically. And so the idea of mastery of an instrument has something to do with making it part of your body. You know, it's just part of you. You live with it. The best way of describing it is that if I can think a sound or a color or a thought, it can immediately be translated through the instrument with fluently. I think that's...
If you can think it.
Yeah.
If you can feel it.
If you can think it and feel it, and you know exactly what to do. I would call mastery. But of course, you never quite have mastery, so you're always either thinking new thoughts that you want to try to see how this might sound, or you might, you know, there are many ways of dealing with it, but basically that's... Yeah. That's
you don't have perfect hands for a cello.
No, you have perfect hands for the cello.
Why is that?
You have large hands.
Yeah.
Your fingers...
Large, you fat hands.
Your fingers are thick. You have thick fingers, thicker than mine.
Yeah, you have long, thin fingers.
I have long, thinner fingers, and it's harder to make a nice, juicy sound. So
I
have
to double up?
Yeah, I double up. I do. How do you know all this? That's good. Cool. So you should play the cello.
You don't want to hear. Let me talk about the cello as a mini instrument.
Mm-hmm.
All the reasons that you found yourself playing the cello. Your dad was what? Was he influential? Was he significant? Was he
very significant? Very influential. He was, I think, in his primarily an educator. You know, he had studied music. He'd studied musicology, violin, composition, did all kinds of things, and really he and because I was born when he was 44, which is fairly late. And they say often, you know, a lot of talented kids come from, are either only children of older parents, and that somehow the parents make a move for the education of the child to find a master teacher. You know, I follow in that general category. But my father really set high standards, but he also created little steps that I could learn from day one to day two to day three.
Step one, then step two, then step three, and it builds your self-esteem as you go.
Absolutely.
Tell me about the listening to, he said during the Nazi occupation of Paris, he would memorize movements of Bach in his head.
That's right.
Made you do that.
Well, he made me do that, which was actually a very nice thing to do, because one of the things I learned from that is that music is something that is soothing and calming. Because if I do that at night before going to bed, it calms you down. If you can generate it yourself, you're not using the radio, actually can create.
You can hear the symphony in the quiet of your head.
That's right. And for my father, actually, that probably was the only thing, a solace that he could, because there was no mail service between France and China, and he was pretty alone at that time, and that obviously helped him through.
You think of yourself as Chinese or American?
I think of myself as me. Both. I'm a product of all the influences. You know, very
born in Paris,
traditional
living
Chinese
America,
family, right?
Educated at Harvard.
Well, some teachers will explicitly.
Educated may be the wrong word. we don't know whether he picked it up or not.
But I have funny memories of France.
Yeah.
All my childhood memories of nursery rhymes, of, the books are from a certain period in France, stays with me. The language, even though I don't speak it that well, I actually have a feel for it. And so I think just the different pieces are all within me. And in fact, part of life's interest, my interest in doing various things is to try and put all those pieces together into a workable whole.
It is said that there is not a wide repertory for cello players.
I beg to differ.
You do?
Yeah, because,
I defer to you. You may know more about this than me.
No, you're right. It is said. You're absolutely right. I beg to differ because I think there's a huge chamber music repertoire.
Yeah.
And I don't view chamber music playing as different from solo playing. Essentially, you have to know the whole score.
Why do you like it? Because I know you like it.
Because it's one of the most thrilling things is to be able to look at someone and through body language know what they're going to do, how they're going to do it, be at the same wavelength with them and do something that you're absolutely in sync with. This is creating sounds, matching them, contradicting them. It's a kind of musical conversation. And you have time to do it. In an orchestra situation, there are always schedules that don't have much time to work. But there you can really get to a very, very good core or center of what the music says, what it says to you, do we agree? And you can get to the bottom of things and really communicate it well.
Are you at a stage now, having been 10, 12 years, for a long time, at the top, really viewed as the way that you are you at the stage now you can really, you've sort of mastered it, in a sense, and you can experiment, you can try, you can be, you can, in a sense, figure out more facets of music. You have time to explore different things. Are you at that stage?
Yeah, I do know what you mean. I'm not sure. I know that I'm lucky.
I'll play it for you.
Okay, can you hum a couple? Yeah. I agree with you that I think that I'm very lucky to be able to, that people will let me try doing many different types of things. I do feel, though, that once you feel you master something, it's a fluid process.
Yeah.
This last week, I just spent a week playing with the New York Philharmonic, playing the Dvorak Concerto, which I've played many times, re-recording it second time, and I felt actually quite insecure. I mean, not insecure in the sense that I don't know what I want to do, but do you really mean this? Do you really mean this is the way you want to think about things? What is it when you do something for the second time? It's, I know I've changed in the 12 years since I've
been. So in a sense, you're reinventing and staying fresh because you come to the music differently
each time.
Different experiences bring a different interpretation.
Right, and the fact that I've learned things about Dvorak's life in his time in the United States, and his friendship with Victor Herbert, all kinds of things help me play differently. It gives me a different idea of what a piece might sound like. And then you want to try to do that and not always sure whether you'll be successful.
That's how you stay fresh.
Yeah.
Continue to look for new ways to approach.
I think every day you got to learn something new.
Do you commission, do you ask composers, are you constantly saying, create new music for me?
Absolutely. That's the other thing to counteract the perception that there's not such a wide repertoire for solo cello. I think one of my great heroes is Rostropovich.
Yeah.
He actually probably multiplied the cello repertoire by a factor of two, by just asking everybody to write music.
Yeah.
And after I sort of learned those pieces, I tried to think about, well, you know, what is it that one could do? And particularly with American composers, I'm particularly interested in trying to get the best people who are writing today to create works for the cello.
Rostropovich, what influence on you?
Oh, someone of unbelievable amount of energy and courage
and
at various
spirit.
Times to say things, and absolutely a passion and a commitment to a life of music.
Did you know Pablo Casals?
Yes. He was my childhood hero, and he still is my hero in many, many ways. He, what I loved about him was that he always said that for him, his first responsibility was as a human being to the world around him, secondly as a musician, and thirdly as a cellist. And I really like that order. Yeah. I think that's a good order. And I think he, in many ways, he lived his life that way. And so when I met him, I met him when I was 7, okay, first of all. And then I met him once again at the Marlboro Music Festival in my teens. I was 15, 16, 17. And he was in his 90s. And that was one of the periods when I didn't know I was going to go into music. And seeing someone at that age be able to walk out in front of an orchestra and come to life was so thrilling. Yeah. I thought to myself, you know, this could be possible. You could really make a life
like this.
Like this, yeah.
Yeah.
It could last.
Isaac Stern. Influence?
Great influence. Huge difference. I think he, first of all, introduced me to my cello teacher, Leonard Rose. He also,
you
I played for him when I was
17 and about 17?
I was nine.
Nine?
I was 9 years old. What happened? I played for him when I was like 5 or 7 or something like that. But when I was 9, he always was helpful in some way. He would listen, he would talk to people, he would talk to me, included me in playing chamber music when I was a teenager.
Yeah.
And now we play a little bit more on a regular basis. But always as someone to lend a helping hand and a very generous spirit.
Was that at Juilliard? Where was it?
This was anywhere, I guess. He, in fact, I went to...
No, with Leonard Rose. Where was Leonard Rose?
Oh, that was at Juilliard.
He was at Juilliard.
Right.
Yeah.
But really, I know the Stern children well. They're good friends, and we kind of all grew up together.
Why'd you go to Harvard?
Why? Because I had no place else to go.
No, you know what I mean. I mean, you didn't need to go to college, did you?
I really wanted to go to college. I think I had such wonderful early training that by the time I was 15, I graduated from high school early, and I knew that I could play pretty well, but I also knew that I was very inexperienced.
Yeah, at life.
At life.
Yeah.
I desperately wanted a piece of something that was not there, which was to go out on my own, go to a different place, and have a number of years to just do things. And if I thought I was going to enter a life in music, I wanted to do something other than that for a while.
A friend of yours told me that they think the reason you can handle all this adulation, fame, all the stuff that comes to one who is as preeminent as you are is because of the education. I mean, you have a sense of how life, and part of that is the teachers you've had, and part of that is the education. It has given you a structure and a foundation, that plus.
Absolutely. Early training from my
family.
My family, my father, my mother, sister. And then later on, I think, Harvard, I met many, many teachers who actually set a certain, very idealistic about what music should be. It's not how you play the instrument, it's your thought process.
Yeah.
It's how you think.
The instrument is simply what? And it plays, what? How does it fit in the scheme of things?
It's your voice, but you have to, I guess, how does it fit in the scheme of things? If you fit it into the voice of the composer, you have to be the advocate of what you know, what's written down. You not have to be not only be the advocate, you have to make it live. And that doesn't necessarily mean you have to be perfect on the instrument. It means that you have to know what it says. You know, so you have to know what to say.
Miles Davis once said to me, he said, what's different? He said, my sound.
Right.
Could you listen to a recording of Casal, Ostropovich, you, and know who played each of it, if it was the same piece? Is that easy or not so easy?
Probably, even though my friends will tell you that I'm terrible at guessing. I've often said, I know this person, I've played with him, and I know that sound, and it turns out to be someone completely different. But I would say to you today that I feel between those people that you just mentioned, I probably would be able to tell you, and I can also tell you, if it were my own playing, that approximately at what time, at what age it was. Because every year I know I've learned a number of things. And so if I hear some playing, I know I haven't thought about this before that period. So I can probably tell you. And that's where, you know, what you put into the instrument really comes out. Sure, Miles Davis is right about what he, you know,
the sound.
It's his sound. On the other hand, you also have to have, because he's playing his music, generally, right?
Right.
But if I'm playing other people's music, I have to find their sound as well as finding my own sound. That's what, you know, then that's the challenge.
We're going to hear now something you recorded for me earlier. This is Bach Cello Suites. Prelude from the first suite. Here it is, Yo-Yo Ma.
I started, you know, two bars at a day.
Every the very day, first and, piece.
Yes,
the you very were four, first. Five, six,
I was
seven.
4 years old, and you know, learned it in I don't know how many, couple weeks, whatever, and it's very interesting. I'm 39, and so I've played this music for 35 years, and it keeps changing.
Because
you learn new things. You think about. You just, you know, this could sound like an exercise. This could sound like a real etude. But the idea behind the prelude for me has something to do with nature element. You know, think of sunrise, you know, leaves, water, something that flows. And certain images just help you get into that place for that piece, and it's just a wonderful discovery to keep trying to do it.
Yeah. You went back to South Africa years ago. You made a doc. You got interested in the subject of what, dancing in South Africa with a tribal dance.
Excuse me. See, I was shaking as you started talking about this. Wow.
Is there something here that
would...
Did something happen in South Africa?
Oh, well, Charlie.
Are there secrets there?
There are definitely secrets there. But I have to
say... Side of you we don't know?
Well, no, I think it's all been documented. In fact, it was an anthropology course.
Yeah.
Where we studied, among other people, the Bushmen of the Kalahari Desert. And I was particularly impressed that there was a blind musician, and there was a film that we saw made by John Marshall of a blind musician. It was called Bitter Melons, and he's playing on some sort of like a, basically, tapping stick to a string and singing. Yeah. And I was so mesmerized by that music. I thought it was so haunting, so beautiful. And I became very interested in the people. And they're very peaceful, peace-loving people, know a tremendous amount about the land. I thought to myself, this is one of my dreams that one day I'd like to go visit.
And you saw them, and then you visited with them, and you said they're dancing. You asked them why they danced. And they said it gave meaning?
It gave meaning to life. I saw one of the trance dances. I went to Namibia, in fact, a couple of years ago, to do a documentary on their music and trance dance practices. And it's amazing. Like, for hours, chanting, clapping, people go around, circle, and then people go into trance. People who have talent go into trance, and they heal one another, I guess, through touching. And the Bushmen are known for that, and people from other tribes come to be healed. And it's the attitude towards trance dancing is very much the same attitude that I think one has as a classical musician. You do this not for yourself. You don't do it because it's my talent, it's my ego. You do it because it's there to be done, and there's a desire for that music to come out. It's a desire from the people to want it to exist. And it was amazing to see this ancient people, have all the artistic elements of what we try to do in 1995 with other types of things.
I have a theory, I've always had this theory, that not always, but musicians live longer than many of us live. And the reason is that music is so much larger than their life, that it gives them somehow, you're able to invest yourself in something that's so much larger than life. And we can look back at a lot of people, Mozart and people like that, that died early. Mm-hmm. But it is so much larger than life, and therefore you see Casals and so many people live such a long and seemingly.
It connects you to life because you can express yourself emotionally, and I think you are pleased by making music. And you connect, I think you're right, the larger life through rhythm. You can have rhythms that are bigger than the piece itself, so you can connect to many, many, many things.
What's next for you? Are you performing, or
still
doing?
I have to go play a concert.
You got to get the heck out of here. No. Where do you want to be 10 years from now, when you're 49, approaching your 50th birthday?
Home.
Watching your kids.
Try home.
That'll be a new experience for you, won't it?
Yo-yo, phone home.
Yes, yo-yo, come home.
I would like to be as excited about life and as excited about my family, and as, my children, and as happy with my wife as I am today. And I think just really, not in the same way, but really enjoying life, and just being grateful for what is around, for the good things that are around.
Great to have you here. Come back anytime.
Thank you.
Thank you very
Wonderful
much.
To see you.
Yo-Yo Ma, as we go out, we will see over credits, what am I going to see? This is a... what is this? This is also from the Bach cello suites from the third suite, yes?
Yeah.
Is that right?
That's right.
How smart am I? You know, it's just so amazing how good I am, isn't it? It's just right here on this little card. Thank you for joining us. Listen to more Yo-Yo Ma. Here it is.
Major funding for Charlie Rose was provided by the people at DuPont, originators of products and ideas that make a difference in everyday life. DuPont, better things for better living. And by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and the annual financial support of viewers like you. Charlie Rose was also made possible by these funders. To order Charlie Rose program transcripts for $5 each and video cassettes for $29.95 each, call 1-800-825-5746 or write to Journal Graphics at the address on your screen. Please indicate show date and guest.
This is PBS.